Good evening. I will begin with the unboxing of the saxophone. The first thing you notice is that there is a really small part. And it is attached, but by default it will come further detached. And when you further detach it, you will discover that you can basically separate it out into two parts. A humble reed and an ebony mouthpiece. So we attach them together. Like that. And in his eagerness, the musician wants to try the mouthpiece and barely succeeds in making something that resembles noise, not even. So it is a little disheartening for the beginner. And then some more rummaging reveals a piece called the neck. So we figure that the neck will slide like this into the mouthpiece into the neck. Okay, so and then you wonder, what more can you do? Okay. It's beginning to sound like a musical instrument. And we pretend there is a body here. So there is already meaned, that's already gamakam. So the Indian musician is already very encouraged. Indian musicians are very hard to be discouraged by. Throw them any challenge and they will make Carnatic music out of it. All it takes is a reed and a neck. But since the box has one big portion that is yet to be discovered, okay. When I first saw this, this was way more complicated than anything I had seen in my life. At least on the domain of musical instruments. Look at the number of buttons here. It's 22 shrutis, there are 25 buttons. How do you do this? So yeah, anyway, we try. Attach the neck to the body. Now what we have is the quintessential look, that of a curved horn, right? Traditionally, Indian music, Indian horns, the Nadaswaram, the Shahanai, are straight horns. If you go further north, up all the way to Tibet, you see a straight horn that goes from here all the way across to the road. And the sound that emanates from it is a very, very, very deep sound. Right, it is below baritone. So that gives us a clue as to why there is a shape like this to the horn. The reason is that the air that flows through the horn does not care if the horn goes across the street or bends within the room or within the little box here. All it cares for is how far it traverses before it emerges out of to the other end. Now that is the length of the vibrating air column, right? So right out of the box, so to say, we start getting clues as to the physics behind the instrument, right? But to this point, we have no idea as to how the operation of the instrument proceeds, or whether or if it is conducive to Carnatic music. At this point, I want to take a small breather from my speculation into the realm of certainty. Right? Here's a little quotation. I have sought to create an instrument which, by the character of its voice, note the use of the word voice, can blend with string instruments, but which possesses greater character, greater strength, and greater intensity. Better than any other, this instrument can finely modify its sounds and preserve a perfect evenness throughout its range. I have made it from brass in the shape of a parabolic cone. Guess who said this? This is the inventor of the saxophone, Mr. Adolf Sax. He has written this as his motivation behind why he wanted the saxophone. So the saxophone is a relatively new instrument, but don't think it is that new. The patent for it was applied in 1840. So just a few years after the Pancharatnas were composed. So had the saxophone been invented in India around the same time, I wouldn't even be eligible to do this talk in front of you. So I thank God that it was Adolf Sax who invented it out there in Brussels or Belgium somewhere. I thank God that the sheet metal technology in those regions of the world there were advanced enough for him to be able to conceive of a shape like this, of a structure like this. I'm also grateful that 100 years prior to the invention of the saxophone, there was already an instrument called the clarinet, and many variations of the clarinet, the bass clarinet, and so on and so forth, which had already incorporated some of the mechanisms. And then around the same time came the advancements in flute making technology. Again, the use of metal, the use of extensions. So essentially, people have been dabbling on how can you produce deeper and richer and more sonorous and more timbral sounds by the use of metal and by use of the state of the art of that time. So this is really technology in action, except that this is almost 200 years in the past, right? The beauty about the saxophone, you know, one of the facts is that it's called the saxophone. Do you know of any other instrument other than the Saraswati Veena, which is named after its inventor, assuming that goddess Saraswati herself invented the Saraswati Veena? We have no proof. But can you think of a single instrument? I'm top of the mind recall. I am unable to. The saxophone was invented and named by the inventor himself as a saxophone. So he was not a modest man. That we can be sure of. Now, you know, he also had foresight, because from the time that he invented the saxophone in about 1840 till the time of his passing on, somewhere in the 1880s, he had gone bankrupt 3 times. Thrice had he become completely penniless. Thrice had he invented a whole new slew of not only musical instruments, but all sorts of things, agricultural implements, name it. He was constantly inventing. And for every one of his inventions, it was sax something. And by just the twist of fate, the only sax something that remains is the saxophone. Long live music. Music will endure all these inventions. The humble flute shall live on. So that is one takeaway that we have. So what happens when somebody comes up with such an original idea? The market alternately rewards and punishes him. So he was awarded the patent, and then for some time there was a great boom. There was fantastic interest. The French army, he was from Belgium, so French speaking nation, he moved to Paris. The French army got wind of this beautiful instrument, and they were at war with Germany. the Germans had their own marching bands. And now, so much of troop morale depends on the marching bands of those days. In the 1800s, warfare was in the field and combat, and marching bands played as much a part of warfare as any other, as the Jawans themselves, as the foot soldiers. So advances in music went hand in hand with advances in weaponry. It was very important. So, you know, you listen to the angels as you die, literally seemed to be happening in the fields of Europe. And here was a great new French invention. So the French army was all over it. They ordered hundreds of saxophones. Adolf Sax became very rich. And then in some time, at those days, the patents expired very quickly. So he had to invent another thing and another thing, by which time others had caught up. As it is the pleasures and perils of technology, is you celebrate and then it just vanishes, and then you have to buy iPhone 12. And you don't even know why it costs so much. Just cause it's new, that's all. So now you have a whole new slew of instruments, a whole new set of requirements, a whole new crown on France. The older crown had been deposed. And since he was favorable to the saxophone, the new king said no more saxophones in our bands. So plummeted fortunes. Adolf Sax again recovered, and so many trials and tribulations he had to file, so many lawsuits, blah, 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 and so on and so forth. So while he achieved such success, it is a debate till date whether he could have done his business better elsewhere, maybe in India. Because look how we have embraced the saxophone. It's been only a few years since saxophone was declared a bona fide Carnatic instrument, so to say, but there are so many people who are taking up this instrument and playing beautiful music from it. Now, there is a beautiful Indian connection that I found out when I was looking through the saxophone. One of the earliest proponents of this instrument was a Frenchman called Charles Jean-Baptiste Soule. And this person learnt to play the saxophone from none other than Adolf Sax himself. And then he went on a world tour. And wherever he went, he would give this instrument a new name. He will call it a turcophone, he'll call it a suophone, he'll call it something else or the other. He'll just keep rebranding this instrument. He was hugely successful. He showed off this horn as a novelty, a new sound. He went across Europe, and slowly but surely he went further and further east through Turkey and landed in India. And then in the 1850s or so, he spent a good time in India. He settled here. He got married. He converted to Islam. And then he composed 40 tunes that became the de facto standards for all the marching bands in that place, in that locality. And he was called the music director and so on. Went back to Europe, came back here. But if you notice, just like Thomas the Apostle landed in India within years of Jesus Christ, here was Mr. Charles Saul, who came to India within few years of the invention of the saxophone. And so this is a really old instrument. It's been discovered and forgotten many times over the history of Indian music. Okay. That being said, let me take a small musical break and play something. Dr. Vijayalakshmy already nailed it. She said that the gamakams are at the heart of our music. There's no question about that. So let's see how the gamakams come forth from the instrument. Then maybe we can talk a little bit about technique. Mm-hmm. It is one of the ragas that encapsulates the spirit of Carnatic music. It just, when I play Bhairavi, I cannot even imagine how old she is. I do not know. I don't even want to know. I don't want some musicologist to tell me it's only 200 years old. Please don't tell me if it is the case. I want to imagine Bhairavi as a timeless, ageless beauty. Bhairavi has always existed, somewhere in the Platonic realm. That's how old and how ancient and how pure and how beautiful this ragam feels to me. And also how chaste and how Carnatic it is. Now, when I can invoke that ragam in an instrument, then I feel that instrument has sufficiently come close to me. And over my years of dabbling with many instruments, I haven't felt very close to so many instruments. So you can imagine how many failures I've had. For a few and far between successes. One such success, I would say, is the saxophone. Not claiming that I am the best saxophone player. My guru is a particularly bad guru. He had the best of gurus. I learned by myself. So, I could have learned from Gadriji. I wasn't fortunate enough. So, with that as my background in the whole realm of dabbling with instruments, discovering this great and lovely sonorous tone that is a saxophone, I want to touch upon the adoption of saxophone in other cultures. So before I go on to that, there is also a Chennai connection. Around 1911 is when the Chennai Corporation had formed and recorded band music. So they had already cut a disc in 1911, imagine, of band music that included the clarinet, the trumpet, the trombone. In the 1911 recording, there are no saxophones. Fast forward 2 decades later, there are 2 saxophones that can be heard in the 1933 recording of the same Madras band orchestra. So you know that the instrument takes foot and gains acceptance very rapidly, no matter what the genre is. If it is an instrument that is conducive, if it is relatively easy to play, right? Speaking of relative ease, I have also learned the violin, and I have to admit that this is a lot easier to play. I still struggle. I'm a vocalist, and when I think musically and I need a gesture, I always go with the violin, because I learned it when I was very young. Okay. இப்படி தான் என் விரல் போகும், இப்படி போகவே போகாது. ஐ ஃபைண்ட் இட் ஆக்வர்ட். இட்ஸ் ஜஸ்ட் வெரி நேச்சுரல் ஃபார் மீ. பட் வென் ஐ புட் மை ஃபிங்கர்ஸ் ஆன் த ஆக்சுவல் வயலின் பிளே தட், அவ்வளோ சௌக்கியமாக இருக்கவே இருக்காது. ரொம்ப நாளாக இப்படி தான், ரொம்ப நாள் வாசிப்பேன், 6 மாதம் 1 வருஷம் வாசிப்பேன், கொஞ்சம் பெட்டர் ஆவேன். ஷோல்டர் வலிக்க ஆரம்பிச்சிடும், கழுத்து வலிக்க ஆரம்பிச்சிடும். இட் சீம்ஸ் அஸ் இஃப் ஐ எம் ஃபேட்டட் டு நாட் கிராஸ் அ லெவல் இன் த வயலின். பட் லக்கிலி ஃபார் மீ தெர் ஆர் தீஸ் அதர் ஈஸியர் இன்ஸ்ட்ருமெண்ட்ஸ். நோ, த பாயிண்ட் ஐ எம் ட்ரைங் டு மேக் இஸ் த சாக்ஸோஃபோன் இஸ் ஈஸி. ஐ ரியலி மீன் இட். இட் இஸ் நாட் டிஃபிகல்ட் டு பிளே. ஓகே, நவ் ஹியர் இஸ் சம்திங் ஃப்ரம் த சாக்ஸோஃபோன் சைரன் ஆஃப் சாட்டன். That is the title, which appeared in the San Francisco Chronicle in 1917. Listen to it. Now, when we think of the saxophone, we always think of jazz music. The greatest saxophonists have been jazz players, right? We don't really think of Mozart concertos or even something like a Berlioz, who came later and who actually used saxophone in some of his compositions. No, we think of the great jazz ensembles. We think of John Coltrane. Right. We think of Duke, we think of Count Basie. These are the names that come to our mind. But look at the reception that the saxophone got in its so-called adopted home, America. No other musical instrument can be so immoral. What does that even mean? What harm does a musical instrument do? Terila. The saxophone is guttural, savage, panting, and low in its appeal. Some severe action must sooner or later be taken upon the matter of our dance music, and measures enforced prohibiting the use of the saxophone in this connection. Okay, so this is an excerpt from this magazine called the San Francisco Chronicle. It's still in publication, by the way. Right? So what happened? I did not feel any of that stuff when I play the saxophone or when I hear the saxophone. I hear great music. Now, I see there are gaps, and I am happy to address it. Now, when I listen to T. N. Rajaratnam Pillai play Todi, I know I cannot play that. It could be the instrument, it could be me, right? So I say, okay, that's where I'll draw the line. Let bygones be bygones. Let him have Todi, and let me have my Kararapriya, and I'll be happy with it, right? So it's not as if I'm dying to explore every Manji and Ahiri and Todi that is out there. I know there is a subset of ragas which can be rendered very beautifully and very chastely in this instrument. Now, and as you all know, this instrument is iconic of jazz. It is in fact iconic of something even bigger. It's iconic of modernity. When you see somebody play the saxophone, the word that comes to your mind is, there can be one of 2 words I am willing to accept either. It's either cool or hot. Okay, so these are the only 2 words that will instantly appear in somebody's imagination when you say it's saxophone. Then comes difficult, easy, conducive, not jazz, classical. It's all a second thought. But this is the beauty of the design of the instrument. But this instrument can also be vilified, I'm saying. Now, when it comes to adaptation, I have a list here that I kind of collected. There is a type of Arabic music called the tarab. And the aim of tarab is to explore not just 22 microtones. They go 2 microtones over. 24. India 22 panna Arabia 2 jaasti pannanungaradho enna theriyala. Ava 24 pannuvaalam. Pandra. Actually, if you listen to Arab music, you can actually hear the microtones. Just like our gamakams are enriched by the oscillations, they actually hit the notes between the antara gantara and the sadharana gantara. They hit the note between the sudharishabham and the sajjamam. They stay in that note. Okay, we don't. We kind of savari paadno. Saveri, right? So that's why we call it Saveri, and but when you play this, I'm not really hitting something between Sa and Re. Saveri, renditiyum vasikiren. The way I phrase it gives you that satisfying Saveri, Saveri, right? Not the case with Arab music. They actually hold notes that are in between those two. Now the saxophone has been adapted into that music with no physical bodily change. This is what I read. I do not know. But I heard it and I believe it. So some great man has actually adopted it. Om Kulthum has used it. Now, if you know anything of Arab and Egyptian music, the epitome of that music is Om Kulthum. She was a legendary Egyptian singer. And her music is to be heard, to be believed. One line eduthundu naraval 45 nimisham pannuva. One vaartha, one line, thirippin thirippin kepa. Audience, that's how she would do her shows. Absolutely divine music. And she uses saxophone from time to time. It's a vindication that we can play 24 gamakams. Okay, in this instrument. So it's not a gamakam that is a problem. That is Kwela in South Africa. I'm just like Rai in Algeria. Many of you know Sheb Mami and Sheb Khaled and those great musicians who have made a new underground sound called Rai. They use saxophone a lot. In Peru, this is interesting. I read that there is a tradition of an orchestra called the Orchestra Typica. Now, the Orchestra Typica uses a very peculiar Peruvian flute, like a pan flute. And until about 100 years ago, they were very strict about not admitting any other instrument except their traditional instruments. Since the 70s and the 80s, the saxophone has managed to enter that ensemble. Not saying that this is great or this is bad. It's not a value judgment. But shouldn't it mean that they were able to play this with a level of fidelity? Definitely. Because they have been very careful about preserving what they had. Even those, by the way, the 1911 and the 1933 Chennai or Madras orchestra that I was talking about, the saxophone players were from Nadaswaram's families. It is very clearly mentioned. So the uptake was from the community that played the greatest Carnatic music there was, which was the Nadaswaram community. So it's a matter of pride, I would say. So now, I played a short ragam and I have a great Mridangam player with me. So I will venture to play something with Talam in it.
Mm-hmm.
That was Begada. Again, a ragam that is very firmly in the middle of great, beautiful glides, glissandros. Out of the 10 gamakams, at least 7 or 8 will be in Begada, illaya? Irkum. So, appadipatta or gamakama alaga vaasika mudiyara or ragam Begada. Adha ennala mudinja varaiyum vaasichen. My tryst with saxophone is actually very recent. I always only think and there are living proofs for that. There are very young people who are taking up the instrument and playing it very nicely. I heard Todi recently by a teenager. Good Todi. So you know it can be done, right? So that is one of my goals. Like, I want to really, what shall I say? I want to demystify. I want to let you know that this is super fun. Carnatic music itself is very fun. Okay, the entry barrier is there, but it doesn't take a long time to overcome that entry barrier. It takes a few hours and for a lifetime of listening pleasure. I look at all the instruments that I have forayed into as extensions of my central sort of self-image as a vocalist. So I think of sila prayogangala vandu vaadyathila kekkumbodhu romba alaga irukum, especially nadaswaram and veena, right? And in Hindustani music, especially in sitar and bansuri. So when it comes to instrumental forays, for me personally, it's all about enhancing my vocal experience for my own sake. Okay? But I have also realized that with some instruments, I go a long distance very quickly. Right? And that enables me to also share that experience with you live, such as what I'm doing right now here. And for me to be able to talk in a very scholarly way about fingering technique in the saxophone, I think it's almost impossible because I never learned fingering technique. I never went onto YouTube and tried to figure it out. I took it out of the box. You just saw me do it, right? I took it out of the box, figured out what the mouthpiece is, what the neck is. I literally did this. The instrument is such a loud instrument that my wife was not very happy that I played it indoors. And back when I actually got a chance to tinker with the saxophone, we lived in the United States. And the only place I could find was a bathroom. So instead of a bathroom singer, I had no bar singing wherever I wanted in the house, but I was a bathroom saxophonist, so that's my beginning. From there to be able to present in front of eminent musicians like Dr. Vijay and Dr. Sriram, I think it is Guru Kripa. That's it. I think Dr. Balamurli Krishna is looking at me from somewhere and smiling and saying, thank you for the music and thank you for listening. If you have any questions, I'll take them now. Yeah. Right.
So I think we have different techniques for singing.
Yeah.
Follow that, or you have your own customized techniques.
Of course. I mean, he is himself a great instrumentalist. He knows the answer. The answer is that everybody customizes the technique, but broadly, breathing into the saxophone is a very different experience from singing. From breathing into the clarinet even, and I play a little bit of the clarinet, or from breathing into the flute, vastly different. If you look at the physics here, the reed is the saxophone is a closed pipe, it's closed on one end. The reed is such a small aperture that you can actually model this as a conical closed pipe. Right? And the equations that come out of it is what gives the saxophone its characteristic sound. Now, so the way you blow into an aperture like this, you have to really imagine your entire body as an extension of the instrument. So I was not kidding when I said that these instruments are extensions of my singing self. Because when you have a certain way of opening your mouth, you are involving your larynx. You are involving your entire breathing respiratory system, and the way you change it will change the way that the kir gandharam pesaradhukku and the note saxophone la pannumbodhu my whole body shape and my from here downwards all the way to my stomach changes in a way that's different from when I sing and different from when I play the flute. So yes, there is certainly a lot of adapting and specific breathing going on. I do not have any generic exercises. Do yoga, sing. That's what I do.
I have a question actually. So in Carnatic music, we tune for different shrutis actually.
Yeah.
So in the saxophone, you just change the fingering and play, or just you play the same one?
No, it's actually a very good question. It's a good question. So the question is, because of the 22 shruti conundrum that we have, and with only 12 notes in a Western instrument, what do? How do you fill the gaps? Of course, you slide gently back and forth, but some keys are not. For example, a flute is different because an open hole flute, a Western flute, what you call a Bohem flute, comes with open holes as well as the ability to key your closures and openings. So you can, at least in theory, if you have fine technique, you can gently close and gently open. The saxophone does not support that. Look at this. This is the bekada ni. Can you see the harmonium sort of sound? So a violinist will be disappointed. Right? But I do a little bit extra. Here's what I do. You can see that the boundaries are vanishing. That's because the way I blow. I'm blowing into the note and out of the note, in and out. So you can build these techniques, and some glissandros can be achieved. As an example, there is this brilliant glissandro in the opening piece of Rhapsody in Blue. So. This was composed by George Gershwin, and the clarinetist does this. It is as remarkable as doing this da gamakam. It is just like such a beautiful glide up. He does it in such a delicate fashion that he blends the blowing and the gliding and the fingering in such delicacy. அது ஒரு பூவை தொடர மாதிரி அழகாக மெதுவாக எடுத்துன்னு போய் அப்படி. ஸோ தேர்ஸ் அ லாட் ஆஃப் ஸ்கில் இன்வால்வ்ட் இன் டூயிங் தேட் அண்ட் ஐ ஆம் ஸ்டில் டிஸ்கவரிங் அ லாட் ஆஃப் இட் மை செல்ஃப். தேங்க்யூ.